Open your Bibles if you have one. In the book of Psalm 148. Psalm 148. Salmo 148. Take a ride with a neighbor. If you are the neighbor who has a Bible and you see a person without the Bible, go after the person and say, I got you, girl. I got you, boy. Now, if you don't have a Bible, you got an iPhone. If there is a will, there is a way. Psalm 148. Hallelujah. That's how it begins. It begins by praising the Lord. Ready? Prontos?
Yes.
Italiano, pronto. Pronto. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise Him from the skies. Praise Him, all His angels. Praise Him, all the armies of heaven. Praise Him, sun and moon. Praise Him, all you twinkling stars. Praise Him, skies above. Praise Him, vapors high above the clouds. Let every created thing praise, give praise to the Lord. For He issued His command, and they came into being. He set them in a place forever and ever. His decree will never be revoked. Somebody say, amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord from the earth, you creatures of the ocean depths, fire and hail, snow and clouds, wind and weather that obey Him, mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals and all livestock, small scurrying animals and birds, living things and kings of the earth and all people, rulers and judges of the earth, young men and young women, old men and children, let them all praise the name of the Lord. For His name is very great. His glory towers over the earth and heaven. And He has made His people strong, honoring His faithful ones, the people of Israel who are close to Him. And this is how He ends. Praise the Lord, amen, amen, amen. Come on, clap your hands and praise the King who's good, who's worthy. And stand up with me for a moment and start calling upon the name of God. God, we ask you today that you will come. Jesus, we want to see a glimpse of you tonight, God. We want to encounter you today in a special way. For we know that you will come tonight. Jesus, all that we need is you. All that we need is your presence. We need your anointing. We need your glory. And we need more of you. And we praise you tonight. In Jesus' mighty name. Come on, clap your hands again and praise Him. Praise the King who's good, who's worthy, who's amazing.
We give our hearts to you tonight, Jesus. We give our voices to you tonight. We worship your name, God. Awake your heart tonight. If you were sleeping, awake your heart tonight, Jesus. This is a new song, amen. Talks about the awakening. The love of God tonight. You can awaken your heart, amen. O amor de Deus possa despertar o teu coração nessa noite. Aleluia. Com as palmas vamos adorar o Senhor. Amém.
There's a wall between us. By the cross you came and broke it down. You broke it down. There's a
another new song, amen, the Spirit to move. If you open our hearts tonight, God is here, amen, but He's gentle. He's here, and He invites you to open your hearts tonight, because we don't want to live a religion, church. We want to live a relationship with God. In relationship, we have to work on it. God, we are here tonight because we want to improve our relationship with you tonight. We want to grow in faith. We want to grow spiritually. So we invite your presence in this room tonight. We open our hearts tonight because we want to hear your voice. Cleanse your heart tonight, God. We cry out for you tonight. We're ready for you. The song's talking about it. Because we're ready. We're ready for you, God, tonight. Hallelujah.
Feeling the wind about to ride in.
recognize you. You can have our minds, you can have our hearts. Everything we surrender to you tonight. Sometimes people, it's hard to trust. We learn in this world not to trust in no one else. Our family teaches, don't trust anyone. But there's a God, and His name is Jesus. You can trust in Him. You can trust your feelings, you can trust your heart. You can trust your family, your business. You can trust in Him. God, we put our hearts in your hand tonight. We give the direction of your life tonight to you. Take care of our lives tonight, God. We don't want to take control, but we ask you tonight. Take the control tonight. We surrender all to you. Because you can have it all. This heart that is not yours.
love you, Jesus. Come on, give somebody a high five tonight, or give somebody a big hug. Embrace a person. Share the love. Come on. Abraça quem está do seu lado aí. Come on. However, let me ask the Brazilian people one thing. Brasileiro, se você não entende inglês, levanta sua mão aí. Okay, one, two, three. Okay, we have some more. Just continue com seus braços para o ar. A gente vai passar para vocês a tradução. Dani Soares is going to do a great job tonight with her carioca accent. Translating a powerful message from behind to you today. Amen. Continue. Continue com seu braço aí para cima se você não fala inglês e precisa de tradutor. Aleluia. All right, can you guys give it up for Annie? Woo!
Hi, family.
Hello.
Special welcome to Melena's family. They're back in the house. Happy birthday, Melena.
Thank you.
Must be extra special. That's right.
Kind of worthy, I think. Thank you.
So everybody, we're in the middle of a 40-day fast that all the Snowball churches worldwide take part in. So every day, Andrea posts the intention on our WhatsApp group. And if you aren't part of the Snowball family WhatsApp, please let us know and we can get you connected with that. Also, Esdras does a daily devotional on the WhatsApp, so if you're interested in participating in that, see Esdras after the service. We do have a prayer box in the back. If you have a personal request, you can write down your prayer. We also have bookmarks in the back that have the locations of our midweek connect groups. So every Wednesday at 8 p.m., we have four small groups to choose from. We have one close to here at the pastor's house, one in Hollywood, one in Venice, and one down in San Diego. So every Wednesday at 8 p.m., try to participate in one of those. We do have a once a month Orange County Bible study, and this month it's going to be July 23rd, and that's going to start at 7 p.m. That's down in Costa Mesa. We also have the Jesus Culture Conference coming up. That's the first weekend in August, August 4th through 6th. The tickets always sell out with that, so if you're interested in going, try to register online. And every Wednesday morning, our Sunday services get posted on the podcasts. So if you have an iPhone, you can just go through the podcast application. Or if you have a Droid, you can download it through SoundCloud, or you can get it from YouTube on Derwin Moore's page. So thank you, Derwin, for your help with that. And just a reminder to please turn off your cell phones. We want to try to limit the distractions throughout the service, and all this would not be possible without you. Thank you for coming.
Hallelujah. We miss Annie, actually, the beach to give announcements, actually.
Yeah.
Hallelujah, that was good. Open your Bibles, if you have one, in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9. Proverbs chapter 3. Starting on verse 9. I'm going to read only two verses, 9 and 10. Proverbios. This is what it says. Honor the Lord with your wealth, moolah, money, treasure, and with the best part of everything you produce. Then he will fill your barns with grain. Somebody say amen. And your vest or vats, which is a container, will overflow with good wine. Now, back in the day, they didn't have refrigerator, okay? So if it was a modern translation, today's translation, it will say to you that your refrigerator will overflow with Coca-Cola, Pepsi, sodas, fancy Fiji water, and all the fancy drinks names that you can get. And truly, guys, when you trust in God, when we come to church, we are trusting that He will speak with us, that He will honor us, that He will do miracles in our lives. But however, there's an area in our lives which is called our financial area too, that we believe that God is faithful enough to complete and to do His miracles and His signs and wonders. Amen? So what I want to do today, real quick, I want you to stand up, every one of you. And I believe God is going to start pouring in your life financially, especially if you're going through a financial problem, financial resource, you don't know what to do here on. Let's trust that the Lord is good. Amen? So close your eyes, and if you have your wallets or your cell phone, if you're giving that push pay today, whatever, just lift up your cell phones or wallets. If you brought cash, lift up the cash, whatever resource you have. Lord, we want to honor you today, God. And we want to ask you today, God, that you open the doors in our financial area, God. And today we trust not only 10% or percentage of our lives, but we trust in you. We give to you 100% of everything we have and everything we are, God. And we ask you today that you do miracles, signs, and wonders, and that your people here in your church, God, can come and testify what you have been doing in their lives, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen, amen, and amen. Amen. Come on, clap your hands and praise Jesus. I want to ask the deacons to come forward, and we have here the box. We have various ways you can give in our church. One is Push Pay, which is a new resource that if you type in your phone 77977 and you write Snowball Church LA all together, it's going to send you to a link. And in the link, you can give as well in the credit card, MasterCard, or whatever way that you want to give. Amen? And also, if you're giving cash today or checks, whatever, the ladies will be here in the front to receive your offering. Amen? God bless you guys. Hallelujah.
Are you love?
that you call church. And we're so thankful that you're doing in this community, God. And we ask today, as we prophesied earlier, that you open the windows of heaven in everyone's area, God. Not only financially, but every single area of their lives, they may see your faithfulness. So we ask today that you bless all the offerings, that you multiply, Jesus, the resources of this church. In Jesus' mighty name, amen, amen, hallelujah. Come on, praise the King Jesus, who is faithful. And guys, truly, we want to thank you today, you know, for giving to church, because that's the only day that this place can be open, amen? And every month we have active activities, festivities, we have rent to pay, so we need your resources, and we thank you so much for contributing in something that is greater than ourselves, amen? Hallelujah. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. Okay, Anna says she wants to give a testimony. How can I say no? It's
okay.
Can you guys hear me?
Gente, primeiro, muito obrigada a todos ontem na praia.
Guys, for everyone who came yesterday, thank you so much.
Você pode aplaudir o Senhor por isso? Foi muito gostoso.
It was so good.
Todo mundo que passava tirava foto.
Every person that passed by, they took pictures.
Eu creio que foi grande começo ali.
We believe that it's a brand new beginning.
E todo mundo, a gente tinha oportunidade de convidar para vir na igreja.
And everybody had an opportunity to be invited to come to church.
Até um cara que estava indo para Nova Zelândia.
Even a guy that went to New Zealand.
Uma menina da Espanha.
Going to New Zealand, or a girl that came from Spain.
E
Chinitos too, right? That's from China.
E aí, o que que foi legal no final?
And what was cool about it in the end?
A gente começou, tinha sobrado um pouco de comida, né, das snacks.
There was a little bit of snacks left that we had.
E a gente falou, vamos aproveitar isso para dar para as pessoas, e a gente aproveita também já para falar de Jesus.
You say, you know what? Let's take advantage and let's pass it on this all this stuff. And let's talk about Jesus.
E todo mundo queria, né?
And everybody, of course, they want leftovers.
Queria uma água ou queria alguma coisa.
They want all water or a sugar bun or cinnamon roll.
E aí tinha uma menina onde eu fui dar uma água para ela.
It was a girl that we came to give a water.
E Deus falou assim.
And God said this.
Fala para ela o quanto eu amo ela.
Tell her how much I love her.
E quando eu fui entregar a água, eu falei, deixa eu te falar uma coisa.
And when I gave her the water, I said, can I tell you something?
Jesus te ama muito, sabia?
Jesus loves you so much.
Você é muito especial para Deus.
And you're so special to God.
E ela ficou parada olhando a minha cara.
And she stopped for a moment and said, whoa.
Eu precisava ouvir isso hoje, ela falou.
And she said, I really needed to hear this.
Eu dei sorriso e fui embora.
And I gave a smile and left.
Aí o Espírito Santo falou, meu, você não sabe fazer direito, né?
And then the Holy Spirit said, you don't know how to do it, right?
Deixa eu te ensinar, né?
Let me teach you how to do it.
Você nem se apresentou.
So you didn't even say your name.
Você nem perguntou se ela quer uma oração.
You didn't even tell that you want a prayer. You even ask her if you want she want a prayer.
E eu falei, ok, vou voltar lá então.
And then I said, you know what, I'm gonna go back there.
Aí eu voltei lá jogando na minha cara de novo. Quando eu voltei lá olhando na minha cara.
So I went back there again and she looked at my face.
Eu falei, desculpa, deixa eu me apresentar para você, né?
And I said, you know what, I'm sorry, let me introduce myself to you.
E aí ela falou o nome dela também.
And she told me her name.
E eu perguntei, você quer que eu faça uma oração por você?
And then Anna asked her, can I pray for you?
Ela falou, pode.
She said, yes.
Mas eu falei, tem alguma oração específica que você quer?
And then she said, you know, do you have a specific prayer?
Ela falou, tem.
You want a specific
a minha
prayer?
Perna esquerda não tá legal.
She says, yes, my left leg, it's not so well.
E eu tô triste porque eu não posso fazer o patins nem skate.
And I'm upset because I cannot do rollerblade or skate.
Era um problema, não era na perna, era meio que na bacia.
And she had a little problem here up in their hip.
Eu falei, amém, então vou orar.
And then she said, amen, let's pray.
Eu falei, Jesus quer te curar.
I said, Jesus wants to heal you.
Mas ele quer também te salvar.
But also he wants to save you.
E aí eu comecei a orar com ela.
And then I start praying.
Primeiro ela ficou quieta assim, tipo, que louca, né?
She was very quiet. She said, man, this is crazy.
Aí depois ela começou a chorar.
And then she started crying.
E eu continuei orando.
And I continue praying.
Eu falei, posso colocar a mão na sua perna?
And I said, can I place my hand on your leg?
E eu continuei orando.
And I continue praying.
Aí eu perguntei, você pode se levantar?
He said, can you stand up now?
Ela levantou.
And she got up.
Falei, você está sentindo alguma dor?
And then she said, and I asked her, do you feel anything?
E ela não conseguia responder porque.
And she couldn't answer.
Porque ela falou tipo,
because she
não,
said,
não estou sentindo.
No, I don't feel anything.
Falei, porque Jesus te curou.
Well, because Jesus healed you.
Só que ela não tinha reação, ela falou assim.
So she had no reaction. She's like,
Ela, você tá me fazendo. Ela falou,
you're tricking me. Like she says, are you tricking me?
Porque você está me fazendo muitas perguntas.
Because you're asking me so many questions.
Eu falei, não, só quero saber como é que tá a dor. Você
não, I just want to know how your pain is. That's all.
Ela, é porque não tem dor.
She said, but, you know, I don't have pain whatsoever.
Eu falei, então, de novo, você foi curado.
So again, you were healed.
E ela ficou paralisada, ela não sabia o que responder.
And she didn't know what to say.
E aí eu abracei ela.
And then I gave her a hug.
E convidei ela para vir na igreja.
And I invited her to come to church.
E a gente.
And she's right here in the back looking. I see it, but she's not.
Mas o que eu quero dizer para você?
What I want to tell you.
Que muitas vezes.
That a lot of times.
A gente passa por pessoas.
We pass by people.
E tem muitos precisando de Jesus.
And there's a lot of people in need of Jesus.
Que a gente nem imagina.
They don't even know.
E ontem,
yesterday,
foi ativado isso em nós.
It was activated in us.
Porque todo mundo começava a parar e perguntar.
Because everybody wanted to stop and ask.
E eu vi muitos de vocês aqui.
And I saw many of you guys here.
Se não todos, né?
Or many of you.
Também
all of you.
Evangelizando e falando com as pessoas.
Also evangelizing and talking to the people.
Muitas vezes a gente só fica voltado aqui para a igreja.
Many times we're just here in the church.
A gente só vem para a igreja.
We just come to church.
Vai embora.
And we leave.
Pessoas passam por nós no dia a dia.
And people pass by day.
Pessoas até perguntam às vezes, você conhece alguma igreja?
And people ask, you know, do you know any church?
E às vezes você nem responde.
And you don't even answer.
Então Deus quer ativar isso em você.
So God wants to activate
that in you. Porque Jesus está voltando, igreja.
Because Jesus is coming back, church.
E nós precisamos anunciar a palavra de Deus.
And we need to share the gospel.
As pessoas estão sedentas.
People are so hungry.
A gente viu isso ontem.
We saw that
todo
yesterday.
Mundo gravava os louvores.
Everybody was recording the praise and worship songs.
As pessoas paravam e viam que tipo o que está acontecendo.
People stop and say, what is this? What is that? What is that?
Amém.
Amen.
Fale de Jesus para as pessoas.
Speak about Jesus.
Ofereça oração para as pessoas.
Offer your prayer to Jesus.
Amém.
Amen.
Glória a Deus.
Vem cá, Luísa. Luísa has a testimony for us. Oh yeah! This is so weird because the board is upside down. There we go. It looks more like home now. I get used to it. The anointing wouldn't come tonight. Woo! What's up?
Huh?
Yeah, it took a while, but we're here, amen? It's like, hold on, 1 second. That helps. Agora vai. Vai com tudo.
Go ahead. Tempo.
Now, I've been wanting to give the testimony in a while. I'm going to try to sum a little bit because it's long.
Vocês,
and I don't want to take too much of your time.
Mas
only 2 hours.
Eu estar aqui hoje foi algo assim totalmente de Deus. Eu estar aqui hoje na Califórnia, entendo.
But being here in California today, it's such a testimony itself.
Pela minha força, pela minha condição financeira, qualquer outra coisa, eu não estaria aqui hoje.
By my financial resources, my condition, I couldn't be here today.
É mais ou menos, acho que quase 1 ano atrás. Yeah. Começou a arder no meu coração assim, uma vontade de ter essa experiência, de vir para cá, de fazer uma viagem para fora, não específico para a Califórnia.
So more than a year ago, my heart was palpitating, telling me I should get out of the country and should come to California.
Mas era algo meio assim, confuso, porque ao mesmo tempo que eu queria ter essa vivência fora do meu país,
that was a little bit confusing. Só dá uma pausa, senão aí eu me perco, eu esqueço. Vai de novo.
Era aquele ditado, se não sabe se casa, eu compro uma bicicleta. Não sabe se viajar, vou casar.
She didn't know if she'll get married or she'll buy a bicycle. One of the situations, you know?
E eu orei e Deus, eu quero de uma forma clara, eu gostaria, né?
And then I pray and ask God, I want a specific way that God can talk to me and give me a sign.
Que o Senhor me revele se isso que está dentro do meu coração é da tua vontade.
And that you reveal to me if whatever it is in my heart, it comes from you.
E eu fui para retiro sabendo que nesse retiro Deus ia falar comigo.
So I went to a conference and I knew that this conference God would speak to me.
E teve culto no sábado à noite e no final desse culto o profeta que estava lá pregando.
And I went to this service and the prophet, the person who was speaking,
ele falou meu nome no microfone.
He spoke my name in the microphone.
E começou a fazer as revelações da coisa da minha vida que tipo só quem me conhece desde criança saberia.
And he started giving revelations that people that know me from way back then would only know.
E ele falou que o Senhor queria me levar a lugares que eu nem imaginava.
And the Lord, through him, told me that the Lord would want to take me places that I couldn't even imagine.
E que ele tinha propósito grandioso na minha vida nisso que ele tinha muitas coisas para fazer na minha vida.
And that he wanted to do many powerful things in my life.
Isso foi para mim a resposta que eu tinha pedido a ele.
And that was an answer that I asked from God.
E a partir dali eu sabia que Deus tinha confirmado, né, essa vontade que eu estava com o desejo certo no coração.
And God really confirmed the desire that I had in my heart.
E comecei a fazer a parte humanamente assim para estar aqui hoje.
And I started doing my part, of course, in coming here.
E foi assim, sobrenatural tudo que aconteceu antes de eu vir para cá.
And it was supernatural everything that happened before I came here.
Vou falar de uma coisa só porque foram várias e
it was multiple things, but I want to specifically tell you about one thing.
Eu fui resolver uma questão do seguro-desemprego para estar aqui e estar recebendo o seguro-desemprego lá.
So I lost my job and I wanted to see about receiving the money that they owe me.
E eu só conseguiria agendar esse seguro para um mês depois da data que eu estava precisando da entrada.
And I could only activate the insurance only a month after I gave the start.
E eu não estaria mais lá nesse período.
And I couldn't even be there in the period of time.
E quando eu fui para tirar uma dúvida, eu fui lá onde dava entrada no seguro para tirar uma dúvida dele. Se eu poderia deixar um documento para uma pessoa assinar por mim.
So I went to this place with the insurances. I wanted to ask him if somebody could retrieve. I couldn't have to be there. Somebody who actually could sign it for me.
E um vigia, assim, um porteiro, um guarda, que trabalhava lá.
The security guard that worked at this insurance place
veio me ajudar perguntando o que eu estava precisando.
He came to ask me what I needed.
E ele me pediu os documentos, se eu tinha os documentos em mãos para dar a entrada.
And he asked me, do you have the documents that, so you can start?
E eu mostrei os documentos a ele e ele falou, tá tudo aí, tá tudo ok para você dar a entrada.
And he told me, look, all the documents are here so you can start the process.
Aí ele falou assim, eu só consegui, eu fui lá para tirar dúvida. So eu só poderia dar entrada um mês depois.
I just wanted to ask a question, so I was going to apply a month later.
E ele falou assim para mim, você volta daqui a uma hora que eu vou te encaixar para você ser atendida hoje na entrada hoje.
And then he said, well, by the way, come in an hour from now, that today we're going to start the process.
Eu agradeci muito a ele, fui embora e voltei em uma hora.
And then I told him, look, I'm going to come back and I'll see you in an hour.
E quando eu voltei, ele colocou a mão no meu ombro.
And when I came back, he put his hands in my shoulder.
E falou assim, eu tô te ajudando.
I'm helping you.
Porque Deus tocou no meu coração e pediu para te ajudar.
Because God touched my heart that I should help you.
E ele nem sabia que eu era cristã, eu não sabia se ele era também.
And I didn't even know if he was Christian, and he didn't even know I was Christian.
Ele só falou isso, Deus tocou no meu coração para te ajudar.
All that he said, you know, God just touched my heart so I could help you.
E eu consegui dar a entrada naquele dia, mas
and I could do the start for the insurance.
Quando, yeah.
And I could do the insurance. I was able to apply for the insurance.
E hoje estou recebendo meu seguro lá, graças a Deus.
And today I'm receiving my insurance there.
E todas as outras, tipo, quando eu cheguei no aeroporto também, eu fui barrado na imigração.
So, when I was at the airport, the immigration stopped me.
mas eu mantive a calma porque eu sabia que se Deus já tinha agido tanta coisa antes de eu estar ali, eu não ia ficar ali.
And I was so calm that if I knew if it wasn't God's will, I wouldn't even be there. So I was really calm.
Eu expliquei, fiz mímica porque eu não tinha que saber inglês, né? Então,
and I explained myself. I tried to mimic, work with my hands.
E consegui passar da imigração e estar aqui na América aqui dentro hoje.
And then I passed immigration and I'm here today. Amen. So, I just want to give you this testimony.
Que quando a gente consegue entender o chamado de Deus e saber que ainda que a gente seja tão falho, ele quer usar a nossa vida.
That whenever God has a call for you, even though we mess up so many times,
você se disponibiliza, ainda que você não entenda nada que esteja acontecendo.
Even though you don't understand, when you are able.
Porque eu tô aqui hoje, mas eu não sei o que vai ser, o que ele quer da minha vida amanhã, qual é o propósito dele.
And I'm here today, and I don't understand what's going to happen tomorrow.
Eu olho para mim e eu não vejo nada de especial em mim, só
and
falha.
I look at myself and only see me messing up all the time.
Mas eu tô disposta a ser tratada por ele.
But I'm here to be able to fulfill God's plans through my life, even though I messed up all the time.
Eu vejo tanta gente que chegou e está sem emprego há anos aqui na América e eu cheguei de duas semanas eu já tinha um emprego.
I see sometimes I come to America and I see so many people that are not in the job. And as soon as I came, 2 weeks later, I was working. Can you clap your hands for that? It's a miracle.
Saiba, tenta escutar a voz de Deus e estar disposto a viver o projeto dele.
So the message is really listen to the voice of God and trust Him that everything is going to work out. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Even though, amen? Let's pray for her. Just stretch your hands towards Louisa. God, we thank you so much for your daughter. She's so special, God. And Lord, we know that all of us, we make mistakes. But we are able. And that's all you want, God. That we'll be able. That we are available. That you can use us. And Lord, we pray that while she's here in America, we don't know how long she's going to stay here, God. A few months, a few years, or all her life. We don't know, God. But you have specific plans for her. She listened to your voice. She was obedient to what you have for her. And let your peace enter her heart. Let your shalom come and touch her life, God. And every step of the way, that she will trust you. And you put the right people, and we believe that you put already the right people surrounding her life. And we thank you for this house. We thank you for this church. That we're able to have people with testimonies, God, just like hers. That we're able to bless those lives through this community. That through this community, we can change this nation. And we can change the world. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Né, pro Rocha? O Rocha abre o microfone. Hallelujah. I got my coffee, I got my water, I'm a happy man, very happy man. I've been waiting for this moment because we've been going through a journey in Paul's epistles, and tonight I want you to open your Bibles in the book of Romans. I believe he has been speaking. And God, we ask that you continue to speak to us tonight. I believe you have great things in store for us tonight. Open your Bibles in Romans chapter 5, verse 12. Starting on verse 12. Romans chapter 5, starting on verse 12. The title of my message tonight, it is The Adams. The Adams. Again, The Adams. Romans chapter 5, verse 12. The Adams. Was up, no, mano. The Adams. Romans chapter 5. Oh, we're starting pretty good tonight. Actually, go with verse 11 with me. I like to just read the portion of verse 11. Sorry, Danny. Confusing Danny right there. Romans chapter 5, verse 11. One before says, so now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God. And we're here tonight, church, not because of religion, amen? But because of relationship with God. That's what it's all about. Because our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends with God. Tell your neighbor, you are a friend of God. Wow, this is so good, isn't it? We talked about Abraham last week. If you missed the church last week, or if you didn't get the message, make sure you tune in to the podcast so you can get last week's message. Amen? Podcast is awesome. It's a little bit long, of course. I preach usually about an hour. So I don't expect you to listen to an hour, of course, a podcast. But you can break it down. So let's say you go to the gym half hour a day. You can do two times or three times. You go to the gym, you can break it down in 20 minutes each time. Or if it takes you 20 minutes to get to work, listen 20 minutes. Next day, listen to another 20 minutes. Amen? And I know God will continue to speak with us. In verse 12, here it is, the main text for tonight. When Adam sinned, sin entered the world. Adam's sin brought death. So death spread to everyone. For everyone's sin, yes. People sinned even before the law was given. But it was not counted as sin because there was not yet any law to break. Still, everyone died from the time of Adam to the time of Moses. Even those who did not disobey an explicit command of God, as Adam did. Now, Adam is a symbol, a representation of Christ who was yet to come. But there is a great difference between Adam's sin and God's gracious gift. Somebody say hallelujah. For the sin of this one man, Adam, brought death to many. But even greater is God's wonderful grace in His gift of forgiveness to many through this other man. Now, who is this other man? And it says here, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And the result of God's gracious gift is very different from the result of the one man's sin. For Adam's sin led to condemnation. But God's free gift leads to our being made right with God. I love this. Even though we are guilty of many sins, for the sin of this one man, Adam, caused death to rule over many. But even greater is God's wonderful grace in his gift of righteousness for all who receive will live in triumph over sin. Amen. In death through this one man, Jesus Christ. Yes, Adam's one sin brought condemnation for everyone. But Christ's one act of righteousness brings a right relationship with God and a new life for everyone. Because one person disobeyed God, many became sinners. But because one other person obeyed God, many will be made right or righteous. God's law was given so that all people could see how sinful they were. But as people sinned more and more, God's wonderful grace became more abundant. In verse 21, so just as sin ruled over all people and brought them to death, now God's wonderful grace rules instead, giving us right standing with God and resulting in eternal life throughout Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Close your eyes for a moment. God, we thank you for these words. We thank you for the foundation of the scriptures. We thank you, Lord, when we read this letter tonight, that you bring wonderful life to all of us. We need you tonight. We need your presence. So we ask you, Jesus, come. Speak to us continually. We thank you for the wonderful moments that we've had since the beginning, God. But we ask that you continue to speak to our hearts so powerfully. We ask you in Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Or you can give it to Jesus, not for me, man. You can do it a little louder. I'm going to clap your hands. For him. For his good. For his everlasting to everlasting to everlasting. I've been so empowered by this book. I've been waiting and longing to preach in Romans. Now, Romans, it's a special letter. It's a special epistle to the church. Some scholars consider boldly to say that Romans is the most important book in the whole Bible. Powerful to say this. It's debatable. For me, of course, the Gospels are the most powerful because it speaks of the birth, the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus. But continually, Paul, he speaks about the same thing. However, the scholars, they call this book, the book of Romans, the gospel of the righteousness of God. It's like the continuation of the gospel. When Paul wrote this epistle, he had not have visited the church in Rome. So of course, as we talked about last week, himself, he did not write with his own handwriting this book, but he had another person next to him. And as he lays out the foundationals of Christianity, which Romans speaks about, he's given us the Christian's doctrine, the most important doctrines of the Bible. Basically, the Christian doctrine, it is here, in the 16th chapter masterpiece of Paul, this amazing gift to the church today. Longing that he didn't even know that when he was trying to edify the church in Rome, he was edifying billions and billions of us all over the world. And if you're thankful for that tonight, come on, give a hand for the book of Romans, which is so powerful. So if yet not, you have not read this book, I encourage you today when you go home, start reading the book of Romans. Amen? It is the masterpiece of Paul again. It is the longest letter. Now you say, well, Lucas, 1 Corinthians has 16 chapters. But this is a little bit bigger. It has so much more wholeness to what we need today. It was written in the Corinth area. It was not written in Rome. Like I said, he had not been yet to Rome. However, he expresses the desire to go visit this church. So he's in Rome in about 56 to 58 between those times. We don't know exactly the year. Might be in 57 after Christ. And he's inspired by the Holy Spirit to write this epistle. Of course, we know that it's written by a man, by Paul, by the greatest apostle of the church, the greatest gift to which I believe the Bible has given us. I don't know anyone who wrote 13 letters, debatable, as I always talk to Luciana, maybe 14, right, Luciana? She says yes, hallelujah. We don't know if Hebrews was his letter to us, his another epistle to us. But here is a gift to the church. Romans is a masterpiece. Romans is when you want to grow your faith. So you want to get out of the first stage of being a born-again believer. We talked about the stages of Christianity, the phases of Christianity. So we go from being a born-again to a convert, all the way to the fullness of the Spirit. And who feels the Spirit tonight here? Who is with me? Amen? Woo! He's so strong tonight. He's so empowering. And I'm so excited to give a little bit of foundation from this book of Romans. Have anyone struggled with worry here tonight? Again, have anyone struggled in your life with worry? Wow, some of you guys never struggle with worry? Hallelujah, I want to be like you when I grow up. I think all of us can relate with worry. Are you with me? I heard a story of a guy who, he was a worry wreck. Like this guy was worried about everything. And he had a brilliant idea. He said, you know what? I'm going to hire a person. I'm going to hire a guy to worry for me. Interesting, isn't it? So, his cousin is talking to him. He said, man, I came up with this brilliant idea. It's like, you know, like, what are you going to do? I'm going to hire someone to worry for me. It's like, one of those wonderful ideas, right? And he said, how much you're going to pay for this guy for him to worry about you? He said, I'm going to pay him $10,000 a week. He said, man, you can't even pay your rent right now. You can't even pay your car payments. How are you going to pay him $10,000 a week? He says, well, that's not for me to worry about. Of course, all of us worry. It is part of our life. But I believe worry is the opposite of faith. And we constantly have to be reminded of our old creation, our old man, our new man. And that's my life was, church. I had this case of constant anxiety. And I remember even at nights, I wake up in the middle of the night as a young kid. I couldn't sleep. And one night, powerfully, I was even like crying. And my father heard me from his room. It was maybe 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. And he came to my room. And he said to me, "What happened, son?" And I said, "I don't know, Dad. You know, I can't sleep." He said, "Why can't you sleep?" I'm worried. And I would constantly worry because growing up, I was in the phase where my parents were breaking up. They got divorced and reconciled maybe about 5 to 10 times. I don't even remember how many times they separated and they came back. Separated, they came back. So worry and anxiety started really hitting me because it was a constant battle in my house. Some of you guys can relate with me if you've been through a broken home where your parents were divorced. It is very difficult because it messes with the emotions of a child. One thing that I recommend, if you are single today, and you're about to get married, or even someone listening online today, I encourage you just to trust God. And if you have, especially if you have kids in a relationship, and kids are involved, don't let them get involved in the decisions where you make. And that's why we need Christ. That's why we need God. Because when we give to Him our emotions, our worries, when we cast onto Him our anxieties, it is no longer belongs to us. Amen? Amen. But now it belongs to God. Amen. Tonight, if you're going through an emotional attack, an anxiety, I highly encourage you to listen to this message. Because this message is for you. Amen?
Amen?
And by beginning tonight, I want you to take a breath really deep. Because many times what happens, we forget to breathe. You know why a lot of people, they get addicted to cigarettes and they smoke more cigarettes than others? It's because sometimes you're so worried. And when they smoke cigarettes, they actually are breathing. And of course you're going to feel better. In Hollywood, they have a few places in LA. I don't know if you heard of this place. But on Sunset Boulevard in Doheny, there is a small room in Hollywood where they stick little things inside of your nose and they turn on a machine of oxygen and you got... And all that is giving you is oxygen that you can breathe. So people get high, they go, "Oh, hallelujah." They don't even know what hallelujah is, but they, "Hallelujah." And why it does it to us? Because we constantly are worried. And when we worry, everything stops. And our life stops. And all of a sudden, you're not productive. And I remember as a young boy, I'm in my room, 3 o'clock in the morning, Daddy comes to the room and then he spoke this word to me. "Son, when you go to bed, give it to God." Here's a father, he never went to church. He's a man that doesn't even know how many books are in the Bible. He's a man that doesn't even know about Apostle Paul. And here's a man who's giving me advice about God. And I love that. Because God uses anyone whom He wants. He used a donkey in the Bible to shape Balaam's life. And He can use a rock to speak to you. Amen?
Amen.
Or even an unbeliever to talk to you and to give you some sense in your life. It is so funny sometimes at work, your boss comes to you, and your boss gives you one of those good, you know? And you know you deserve it. Now your boss may be the devil, but let me tell you something. Those things will shape us, man, right? Those things will make us grow. And those things will make us better employees, better servants, and even better believers. So my father says to me, give it to God. I kid you not. After that day, I never had another anxiety moment in my life. And today, I told, I think Dionne did this yesterday, when I hit the pillow, I'm gone, baby. There are two Adams in the Bible. Clearly, we start speaking about Adam because of Adam of Genesis. Genesis chapter 2, chapter 3. Beginning of creation in chapter 1, God created heaven and earth and everything in it. He gives us a proportion of scriptures that talks about rest, which is one of the greatest principles, and is even in the top 10 of the commands of God to us. The commandment of God, which speaks about Sabbath. We may, when people talk to you about not cheating on your wife, you say, amen. Do not adultery, do not rob, do not do everything. You know, praise the Lord in everything you have. The first command, to honor God with everything you have. Honor your neighbor as yourself. You include all the commandments and you combine them in one. All the commands of the Bible, the top 10 commandments of the Bible are good, and you say, oh, it's for me. When you think about jealousy, the 10th commandment, not shalt thou look at your neighbor's conquests, look at your neighbor's accomplishments, look at your neighbor's cars and houses and servants. Don't look at your neighbor's. You say, all those things are good for me. And it gets a little bit confusing to say, you know, save the Sabbath. Like, what that has to do with anything today? Christians don't save the Sabbath. Well, it gives a great reminder of the scriptures, which I love, reading again the book of Genesis, which it talks about work and labor and do everything you got to do in 6 days. And on the seventh day, what you must do is give it to God. And it is a reminder that it tells you and I that when you give it to God, He's working in your behalf. And it is really good. Because when you are worried and you give it to God, all of a sudden there's something inside of you that disappears. There's a burden that you're carrying for a really long time, and you didn't know how to resolve it. And all of a sudden, this burden is gone. Now, the reason you and I, we don't save the Sabbath, so-called, it is because of Jesus Christ. Because He is our rest. He is our Sabbath. And He give us the rest that we need. Amen. Can you clap your hands for Jesus? That's all we need, is Jesus. And no longer we save the Sabbath, but He saved us. Amen. From the Sabbath, from the law, and from any condemnation. So Paul is giving us this decree, this doctrine, that no longer has nothing to do with works, with commandments. And it goes even before Adam, saying that Adam, he sinned. Even before it was a thing called commandment. unto the time of Moses. And he says to us here in Romans that even though they didn't knew anything about the commandments, we are suffering. And he died. And humanity is suffering because of Adam and Eve. Now my wife says when she sees Eve in heaven, she's going to take some of the good stuff, you know? And some of you women here too. However, we don't know if Adam and Eve are in heaven or hell. No, just kidding. I don't know. They're probably in heaven with Jesus. Hallelujah. Maybe not. I don't know. No, just kidding. But it has nothing to do with how much we work. And it has everything to do, Romans tells us here, of how much he works for us. And then he talks about, obviously, he gives the doctrine of all the scriptures from chapter 1 to all the one verse 11. He talks about life, how to live a life, how to live a Christian life. He lays all the foundationals of Christianity for you and I. And then he speaks to us how to live a doctrine. So he combines the life of a Christian life with the doctrine of life, and he gives us the perfect life of Christianity. The perfect Christian life for you and I today. Paul was really inspired by God and by the Holy Spirit. Church has everything to do with the grace of God. The grace of God is the biggest gift that Jesus Christ gave us. Amen? So again, rest. Adam would always come back to you and say, no, labor a little bit more. Adam would always come back to you and say, no, work a little bit more. The first Adam would always say to you, no, man, that's not how it is. You pray too much. You should do a little bit more. The old Adam, the old man, would always try to resurrect from the grave. From the moment that you became a believer, from the moment you gave your life to Jesus, your old self, your old you, died. You buried the old man. And here from that moment you get baptized. You rose from the water. Heaven opened. I don't know if it happened to you. Thy good and faithful servant. This is my son whom I am well pleased. There's a powerful life ahead of you. Some of you guys who've been baptized, you know what I'm talking about. Because it's like after you're baptized, you're like floating in the skies. There's a new power that God has given to you. There is a new understanding about God. But let me tell you that Adam always runs after you. The old Adam, the old man, runs always after you. And these are the actions of the first Adam. He disobeyed God's commandment. His action caused sin to enter the world. And with the entrance of sin came death. And all creation has been afflicted by the disobedience of Adam. Now here comes the actions of the second Adam. Are you with me tonight?
Yeah.
Number one, he was obedient to the work he received from the Father. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
His action caused men in sin to have a second chance to be restored. Number three, with his death came the eternal life offered to all who will accept it. And number four, in all creation will be restored at the end because of Christ Jesus. Come on, clap your hands tonight. That there is restoration for all creation. I love Jesus. Adam came, and it was a perfect life that God has given to Adam and Eve. It was a perfect world that Adam and Eve lived in. There was no pimples. We don't need deodorant. You don't need shampoo. You didn't need straightener, chapinha. You don't need anything. It was perfect. It was no magazines that should we compare ourselves with one another. Media was not telling us what you should be like, how you should talk, how you should dress. But it was a perfect plan that God had in mind for His creation. And let me tell you something. Before you judge Adam and Eve, if Adam and Eve didn't commit the sin of taking from the tree on the middle of the garden of the knowledge of good and evil, we would have ate the tree of the fruit of the tree. So before we judge them, we have to look at ourselves. Because there's no perfect person in this world today. And all we need is Paul reminding us here today, it is only by the grace of God, in the grace of God alone. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So let's compare real quick the first and the second Adam. The first Adam was from the land, and the second Adam was from heaven. Open your Bibles in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 45. I love this. The first was from the land, and the second, it was from heaven. The scripture tells us in verse 45, sorry. Again, the scripture tells us the first man, Adam, became a living person. But the last Adam, that is Christ, is a life-giving spirit that comes first in the natural body, then the spiritual body comes later. Adam, the first man, was made from the dust of the earth, while Christ, the second man, came from heaven. Earthly people are like the earthly man, and heavenly people are like the heavenly man. Just as we are now like the earthly man, we will someday be like the heavenly man. Amen? And I can't wait for that day. In verse 50 says, what I'm saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that our physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. That these dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever. And here Paul gives us a secret. He says, well, let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. We will not all die. Amen? But we will be transformed. I love this. And it will happen in a moment, in a blink of an eye, when the last trumpet is blown. For when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to life forever. And we who are living will also be transformed. Hallelujah. Come on, clap your hands tonight. And I couldn't wait for this transformation. And transformation starts today, church. Transformation is not waiting for you. We should be waiting for transformation. This is what we should long for every day of our lives. For some of us, we think, man, I grew up in church. I was born at church. My mom was singing when I almost had it. The pastor was probably doing the birthing. It doesn't matter if you're born inside of the church and born inside of the walls. But the question is, are you born of the Spirit?
Amen.
Transformation, church, is every day. Because when we think we reach the highest of heaven, when we think we have the fullness of the Spirit of God, hear my prophesying to the world, hear my the missionary of the nations, here I'm the one Paul, the new Paul of 2016, the 21st century. That's when we trouble. And we forget to humble ourselves. We forget about humility. We forget it's only about Christ and it's not about ourselves. And Paul was reminding him, which Adam are you? Are you like the old Adam? Who think I got it all? It's okay if I eat of the tree. I'm fine. I'm okay. I can taste a little bit of sin. It is okay, just for a little bit. But let me tell you, brothers and sisters, sin have its consequences. Sin tastes good, but then what happens? It leaves an aftertaste. Taste has a bitter taste afterwards. Kind of like dark chocolate a little bit. Kind of like coffee. If you don't brush your teeth after you having coffee, man, somebody people say, hallelujah, get away from me. Right? Dangerous. The first Adam transgressed. The second never sinned. John 8:29 says, and the one who sent me is with me. He has not deserted me, for I always do what it pleases him. Thank God that Christ has never sinned. Because today we can have the Spirit of God that dwells in us. Today we can have the salvation, the certainty of salvation, that when we die today, that if anything happens to our lives today, like you see that video, a pastor's preaching in the church, Christ could come a year from now. Christ could come a month from now. Christ could come. All of a sudden, 3, 4, 5 people left behind in church. Have you guys seen that video before?
Yeah.
It could happen anytime, church. The first Adam brought death, and the second brought life. John 1:4 says, the Word gave life to everything that was created. And His life brought light to everyone. There's a difference in you. Recently, I was driving an NBA player. I cannot say his name, but I'm sharing the gospel with this man. He seemed a little bit down. He needed a little bit of word of encouragement. And I told him I was a pastor, that I had the most beautiful church in Los Angeles. Yeah. Hallelujah, you get it. And he said, man, thank you. I have a gift for you. This gift, I use it every time I play. And I want to give it to you today. I said, really, man? Thank you. So he gives me this rubber bracelet. And it says, in Jesus' name, I play. In Jesus' name, I'm preaching tonight. Amen? Amen? You never know who you drive, church. People you think they're lost. Sometimes all they need is a little word of encouragement. Amen? And this is what Christ did. Christ shared light. Yesterday, we're right in the midst of the darkness, the darkest place in Los Angeles. Some people say it's downtown. Some people say it's Long Beach. But I believe Venice Beach really needs Jesus. It is the biggest youth homeless of the nation. There are youth homeless in Venice Beach than any other part of the world. I didn't want to tell you this yesterday, but a friend of mine told me a story that he was surfing one of these days early morning. And he says, Lucas, do you know where we're standing here? Yesterday he's telling me this. Do you know where we're standing here, man? You know, like you see at NASA, the guys are like they have this extraordinary cape, clothes, that they have, you know, oxygen inside of these masks. And they use this clothes, you know, that so they would not be contaminated. He says to me that every morning at 6 a.m. or earlier, there are those NASA men that they bring chlorine to the streets of Venice and through all the grass areas of Venice Beach. And they're pouring out because there's so much, number one and number two, all scattered around, vomit, drinks, you know, alcohol all over, that you can barely walk into the grass area where we're standing yesterday. That's where we are. That's where we were. Hallelujah. And we're laying, taking pictures in the grass. Disgusting. Next month we'll be there. But let me say something to you. It is a price that we pay. You know, we know there's a lot of stuff going on in Venice Beach. But they need the light of Jesus in their lives. I was talking to the guys that go to the rollerblade area behind where we work. For 20 years, every Saturday and Sunday, they're there. The lady, she looked like maybe 75 years old in a rollerblade. Maybe she was like, you know, 20 years old when she first started going, you know? And there she thinks she's like 20. If you're there, you know what I'm talking about. But I went there and I said to her, Anna was asking me, Lucas, can you go and tell just to put the music down? And I said, fine, you know, whatever you tell your wife tells you, you do it. So I go out there to talk to them and the guy, and I'm trying to make a conversation with the guy, you know. And then he tells me, you know how long we've been here? Yeah, 20 years. The person before us, another 20 years. 40 years. It's like, well, okay. Maybe, perhaps, why don't you maybe lower the music down? Never mind. I said, we have some food back there if you like. Some water, some refreshments, you know. But they did lower down the music. Amen? And we're able to sing. And after we had, they heard us singing and praising God. And Pam, which is the lady who came and sang, she came afterwards and she talked to us. And she was really sweet. She was really open. All the people are longing for church. It's love of God. They just don't know it is in Jesus. It is in Christ alone that we have salvation. And only the works of God, the works of Christ, and the actions of Adam and Eve and the actions through Christ, the new Adam, can cause to change humanity today. Anna, I'm going to ask the band to come up. Anna, wherever you are, come. I need your help. I want to ask you tonight, which are the actions? Which of your actions have changed your life lately? Which are the actions that you've lately been having that have been changing your life? Have an action that would change your life forever, except Jesus. Only the new Adam can reconcile us again back with God. We make many mistakes. And what happens? The enemy would always try and bring about the old thoughts of the past, so we can again entangle ourselves and remind ourselves again how many times we messed up. It is easy to always forget of how much God loves us and how much He wants to change us, how much He wants to use us, and how much work that He wants to do in our lives. But the reminder here is this: it doesn't depend on you. It depends on Christ. And the key is tonight that I want you to have and understand that there is a Sabbath in your life that God wants you to get in. There is a Sabbath of God, which is the renewal of Christ that He wants us to get in. There is a peace of God which is called Shalom that comes from heaven. That whatever the place you get in, people can feel and sense. Not because you are a good person, but because how good God is in your life. And He wants to change us. He wants to renew us. And He wants to give new life. I want you to close your eyes for a moment. There's a renew that comes in Jesus' name. Before we continue our talk, we're almost done. I want to ask the deacons to come, including Rogerio, to the front here today. And why I'm asking the deacons to come forward today, it is because these deacons here, which are the representatives of the church, we have so much to thank them for the work that God is doing in their lives. The only few people that Paul describes and talks about, and there's only one person that He honors in these scriptures. It is recorded in the chapter 16 of Romans. And He speaks about a lady. Her name was Phoebe. And He writes a letter on chapter 16. And He talks about how gracious and how faithful she is. And she says that if the church of Rome, would accept the deacons, would accept Phoebe, they would be so privileged to have them in their church because how faithful she is. Today, we're in the midst of a fasting in our church. And today, we're praying specifically for the elders and for the deacons of the church. I'm going to ask the church today, if you can, to stand up with me. If you can, you better for a moment. We want to honor the deacons today. and praying for them. Because we believe the deacons in our church have represented the foundation of our church. We're not neglecting, again, if you're not a deacon, the work that you do for this church. However, today we want to specifically bless and pray for the deacons, because today it is the day that we pray for them. Amen?
Amen.
So Lord, tonight we honor, just like Paul honored Phoebe 2,000 years ago, we honor your deacons today, God. And we ask that your grace will fall upon them, Lord. And that your power would overwhelm them, God. We pray for the generation that you have raised, because these deacons have been chosen from heaven, and they are yours, God. So we ask that you open the doors of opportunity in relationships. The Lord, that you build families, and that you build generations to generations from these deacons, God. We thank them for the work that they do. We thank you, Lord, that you have blessed them so far, all these years. But we're so excited to see that by your grace, they overcome, Lord, so much in this world. And Lord, we ask that you do that. In Jesus' mighty name, amen, amen, and amen. Come on, can you clap?